At one public hospital, when I asked the hypothetical question, "Can I have an abortion here?" I was told there were two answers to that question. I was asked whether I wanted the official one or the unofficial one. The official answer was, "No, we do not provide abortions here." When I asked why, I was told, "Because of the legal uncertainty." I was told the unofficial answer is, "Yes, you have to go back to your GP, get your GP to put you on the day procedure list, and come back through that door rather than the front door."
An upper house vote to decriminalise abortion has thrown state parliament into chaos.
After weeks of stunts, protests and lobbying, it's now down to business.
That matter is simply a matter for the House.
It's up to you to decide that the unborn are worth fighting for.
Political leaders are appealing for calm.
Madam, restrain yourself. Where is the security? Remove her anyway.
Catholic Church has used today's Sunday services to pray for the defeat of the abortion law reform bill currently before state parliament.
I cried. It was such an important moment for women. Finally, our state legislature had said, "You are fully human. We do trust you to make the right decisions about when you have your babies."
It was sort of unreal. It's happened. It's over. It was amazing. And then to walk out onto the streets of Melbourne that were nearly empty, I think, what do we do now?
It was an amazing moment for those women who had been that group of women who made sure that my generation of women actually had access to safe abortions.
But the feeling of walking into the parliament, into the upper house where I had served, into the parliament, knowing that this place of which I'd been part and of which Maxine and Candy were part, and Lily and others, had passed such momentous legislation, made the whole life of being a politician, a parliamentarian, worthwhile.
For too long, too many women had suffered without access to good abortion services. Poor women and country women had no access at all. Those women who could find doctors risked jail, and those who could not risked death at the hands of backyard abortionists. Through the 50s and 60s, good services were available, but their survival relied on a corrupt police force and a network of whispers and subterfuge. In 1969, the Menhinnitt ruling proclaimed that abortion was legal if the health of the woman was paramount, but the ruling was judicial and not enacted within the criminal code. Abortion remained a crime.
Intermittently over the years, I would turn up in the Parliament House and ask the Attorney General or other relevant ministers, "Is this the right time to change the law?" And they all said, "Not me, I'm not going to do it."
When we worked hard in the Labor Party to get the affirmative action rule, which would bring the number of progressive women into Parliament we needed to make women's issues political issues and to shift them from women to the whole community. When we fought that fight and won it in 1994 in the rules, we kind of sat back and waited for it to happen. But it didn't happen. You've got to change more than the rules, you've got to change the culture. So our task became to change the culture, to get people to recognise abortion law reform as a right.
And when Joan Kerner rings you, you do jump. So she said, "We need to do something." I said, "We need to do something." We agree, let's have a conversation about this. And part of that was, we can't afford to try to react and fix up after we've lost a range of things. We have to, in fact, develop a much more proactive agenda.
First of all, we needed to be absolutely clear that we wanted abortion, safe abortion, to be legal in Victoria. That was it. That's what we wanted. Not to remain illegal, but you could do it under certain circumstances. Secondly, we knew we needed partners, networks. And we already had those in the feminist movement, people like Marilyn Beaumont in Women's Health Victoria, people in Royal Women's Hospital. We already had all those contacts, the YWCA, Murray Stopes, Susie Allison's centre. So, but we needed to firm it up and we needed to get us formally working together.
We would never have been, in my view, as successful if it hadn't been for Tony Abbott. So because we had this incredibly anti-choice health minister, he was the one who got us mobilised. He got an entire nation of women alert and alarmed and very, very eager not just to defend their rights, but to actually push the agenda forward despite his resistance.
So to arrive at Trades Hall and see a room packed with these vocal, educated, articulate women from all walks of life demanding that abortion be decriminalised was absolutely wonderful. I thought, wow, I didn't even know this. I didn't know all these women were there.
A lot of the volunteers were university students who were involved in activism on campus. And also, we also had the other end of the extreme of retired women who knew about backyard abortions personally, you know, and they wanted to be part of this legislation and be about, you know, literally burying this part of our criminal history.
One of the things that I had already learned but was coming to learn even more was that in order to get politicians to act, you have to put pressure on them from the outside. They have to feel like people in the community are watching them, care about this issue, and will mark them down at the ballot box next time if they don't do something about it.
We always knew that there were going to be attacks, particularly on members of parliament, and we always knew that that part of the success of this was making members of parliament feel safe to make the decision that they felt was right for them.
The reason behind telling my story was pretty much the same as motivated those women who marched back in the 70s saying, come on, come out and arrest us. Are you saying what we've all done is criminal? We say it's a much needed health service and a right. It was partly personal, but it was also because I am the Health Services Commissioner. And I thought that that would add weight to the campaign.
During the campaign, we talked a lot about the last taboo. We talked about how women were stigmatised because they'd had an abortion and the fact that they couldn't talk about it. And it was during that time that I made a decision to actually do an interview. One of the important things out of that was the huge amount of emails and letters I received from women in my age, I'm 51, who had had both legal and illegal abortions, and just saying it was great to hear someone talking about it because it was normal, it was ordinary.
Now, we had put up with picketers out the front and I thought it was appalling that they were there, their behaviour was appalling, but oh, well, you thought, well, they have a right to express their view, etc., etc. But when our security guard was killed, that was it for me.
In 2001, Peter James Knight shot a security guard dead outside a Melbourne abortion clinic. He was described as obsessed with killing abortion doctors.
I thought that if people just understood the work that we actually do, if people understood women's stories, the women who come in here and their lives and how they have thought really thoroughly about what they're doing and that they're choosing to have an abortion for very good reason, if people understood that, then things would change and there wouldn't be picketers out the front. They wouldn't be allowed. And that there would be a better Medicare rebate. There would be better access to the pill. A whole range of things would change. So I became quite driven with that.
Maybe it's me, maybe it's because I'm a doctor. I didn't have a tendency to be involved in a movement or in achieving political change previously. I hadn't felt as strongly about an issue because this had affected terribly so many of my patients for so many years. When they have a diagnosis, they should be able to access abortion, and they get pushed from pillar to post, from hospital. Some people get told no, and they go ahead with a pregnancy, which an abortion would have been lawful. They were told something that wasn't true.